my old friend, Mr. Chris Jericho. You know, you think you could have been a little considerate and back-timed it right out of your song, but now you sit through Dream Theater.
Well, you know, I'm a lead singer, so I have to always be a little bit late.
Are you developing LSD, Jericho?
Yes, I've always had LSD, Eddie, you know that. And that's why I figured you played Panic Attack, because you were starting to have those panic attacks that you always have when things start going awry on your radio show.
Well, you know, I said going into it, I said, I've been doing radio now, next year it'll be 30 years, and I can't tell you how many times I've tried to do that move where you play the artist's song and then you have them on, and, you know, right with 30 seconds left, they should call if they're on time. And it's really worked out maybe 5% of the time I've ever tried to do it. So I don't know why I'm like a glutton for punishment. I try it every time. It just never works. But you have a little wrestling gig tonight, so at least you have a valid excuse, right?
Yeah, I'm actually in Dallas for Raw. And it's interesting because when we did the Chase and the Grail record back in 2010, that's when we really started, you know, going full bore with Fozzy. And I mean, you can't do wrestling and music at the same time. So we toured with Chase and the Grail. I left the WWE. Then when we finished that tour and we started working on Sin and Bones, I had about 9 months of time off, basically, because when you're the singer, all I do is, you know, write the lyrics and sing in the studio, which takes about 15 days. So I had about... I decided to go back to the WWE, and then that finishes up basically next week, and then we start the Uproar tour, and Sin and Bones comes out, and we go back around the world again. So I'm kind of tagging out from WWE and going back full-time into Fozzy, but this is kind of the last few shows this week and then next week.
So how, I mean, obviously the plan is in place for your exit once again from wrestling?
Well, it's not going to be so grandiose. I mean, from the moment that I contacted, you know, Vince McMahon about coming back, I told him, you know, our record comes out in August, and this Uproar tour starts August 17th, you know, which is the biggest tour we've ever had, especially in the States. So I'm just going to be focusing on the band, and, you know, all the great momentum and all the, you know, all the accolades that we built up over Chasing the Grail. We wanted to keep that momentum going, because as you know, in the music business, and you're out of sight, out of mind, you know, here today, gone later today, as David Lee Roth would always say. So we wanted to continue to build on that momentum that we started, and continue to take the band to the next level, which has been working great. And it's by far the biggest buzz we've ever had for a record is on Sin and Bones, and the most radio play and all that sort of stuff. So it's a good time for us.
Well, it's pretty interesting, because before you came on, I was talking about that exact thing where, you know, I remember vividly the earliest days of Fozzy, because you know, there's a great story for people that never heard it, where on my FM show, you, at the time, everybody knows you guys had character names in Fozzy, and the album was predominantly covers, the early record. I didn't know what to make of it, and I didn't really know you back then, and you were trying to come on my show, and I couldn't figure it all out. And I was like, you know, it's amazing what's happened, how we've gone from that in, what, 10 years to where it is now, where this is... as you said, greatly reviewed album. You just played Download. I mean, it really seems like it's going in the direction you probably wanted it to go all along, as far as a very viable, credible, real hard rock band, right?
Yeah, we had the one of the weirdest starts ever, in that, you know, Rich Ward and myself just started playing gigs. You know, people always ask where you get the name Fozzy. We started playing gigs as Fozzy Osbourne, just a cover band in Atlanta. We kind of connected, and we were just having some fun with it. And because Jericho from the WWE and Rich Ward from Stuck Mojo were playing in a band, we got offered, there was a bidding war for our band after two gigs, believe it or not, back in the days when they still had record companies that would do that. And we got signed to Mega Force Records by Johnny Zazula. Now, Johnny Zazula, as everyone knows, is a guy who, you know, signed Metallica first, signed Anthrax, and he was so into this whole thing. And that's kind of, we were like, you know, we do realize we're just playing covers, Johnny. And he was like, I know, but it's great. I love it. So we came up with the idea of doing something different, kind of a Blues Brothers, Traveling Wilbury type of a vibe. And then after the second record, we said, you know, we really want to do this and do our own music. And we love playing together. And, you know, that started with All That Remains, then Chasing the Grail, and now with Sin and Bones. And I almost compare it to Pantera. there's two versions of Pantera. There's the Pantera that did, you know, power metal and metal magic and wore the makeup and, you know, all that sort of stuff. And it was different. And then suddenly in 1990, they kind of reconfigured who they were and changed the style of music they were playing and became the Pantera that went on to, you know, be the band that we all love. Kind of what happened with Fozzy. There's the first version of Fozzy Mark One, and then there's Fozzy as 2005, which has led us to here today. So it's a very weird way to start, but the last three records have just been you know, better and bigger than the one before it. And, I mean, this is the real deal. I mean, I've been playing in bands since I was 12 years old, and I always wanted to be in a rock and roll band, and I wanted to be a wrestler, and I was stupid slash lucky slash crazy enough to have them both happen.
I was going to say, I mean, reading your books and stuff and knowing where your passions are with wrestling and music, I mean, it's got to be a great sense of accomplishment to know you've really clearly succeeded and been successful and, I mean, done a great job in both areas now. I mean, obviously the wrestling thing has been there for you for a long time, but now to see where Fozzy is going, I mean, God, I mean, I'm picking up the British rock magazines and stuff, and I'm seeing you listed right in there with all the big bands that we loved and stuff with Fozzy and on the gigs and playing Download and stuff like that. I mean, this has really started to kind of catch up to that. I mean, it's kind of got to be kind of pinch yourself at some point that you're making a living and succeeding in your two greatest passions, man.
Yeah, thanks, man. And that's the thing, like, you know, this wouldn't have gotten as far as it was if it wasn't for two things, for being a passion and for the fact that we have, you know, a great band that Rich Wolf formed and was the best guitar players, writers in the world, and we're slowly changing that. But I think it's very cool, and, you know, we have, you know, we've toured with Anthrax, like you said, we did Download with Metallica, we're going over to Soundwave in Australia with Metallica, we're touring, you know, with Shinedown and Papa Roach, we've done shows with Avenged Sevenfold, we're touring with Bullet for My Valentine, so we kind of got the best of both worlds as far as bands that are like 10 years older than us and bands that are 10 years younger, and we kind of appeal to fans of both, which is, we kind of do something that's not like, I'm not going to say that nobody else does it, but, you know, the very heavy riffs with the very melodic choruses, it's almost like if you took like Metallica and you know, crossbred them with Journey, so you might have something that Fozzy does. And I think that's another reason why we've gotten to as far as we have, because we do something that's a little bit off kilter from what's going on now, and that's appealed to a lot of people. And, you know, and like you said, man, I mean, it's great to have all of these peers that dig the band, and it's reciprocal, and then to see the fans kind of getting into it. I always say the only people that don't really like Fozzy are people that have never heard us, and there's always a little bit of a prejudice because, oh, that's the wrestling guy's band. But it was never about wrestling. It's not like we ever went on stage in, you know, in spandex trunks and sang about chair shots and, you know, hitting the ropes. It was never about that. So, you know, Bruce Dickinson's an airline pilot, but he didn't go on stage singing about small bags of peanuts and sitting in row 3CD. You know, it's just kind of something that he does when he's on stage with Maiden. I think people've kind of figured that out about Jericho as far as Fozzy and WWE as well.
So what percentage would you say now, I mean, because obviously the first fans for Fozzy were people that, and it only makes sense, would be people that would have been fans of yours through wrestling to see what you're doing on the music stage. So what percentage of the Fozzy audience now do you think are still the wrestling fans versus people that are there purely because they just know you and the music through Fozzy?
Well, I mean, Paul Stanley said it best, and you're as big of a kid fan as I am. He said you can't put a bomb inside of a record, and that's the best thing about it. I mean, Kiss had this amazing gimmick. I mean, every band has the gimmick, right? And Kiss had the gimmick, but when you took the records home, it was either good music or bad music. You couldn't, you know, erect a 17-foot Kiss sign in your house and have bombs going off and all that sort of stuff. It was all about the music, and I think that's what happened with Fozzy. It did start out being predominantly wrestling fans and Stuck Mojo fans, and then kind of it switched to, there's a lot of Jericho fans, and that's fine. There's a lot of people that like wrestling and like metal. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. But there's people now, the majority of the fans that we have know the words, know the lyrics, know the band, and I don't think that they really care too much about the wrestling thing. I think some of them think it's okay, but it's almost like 30 Seconds to Mars, the band that Jared Leto fronts. Great singer, great band, if you like that type of music, and he just happens to be, you know, a Golden Globe winning actor as well. It's not the actor's band, it's just the guy who's in a band that happens to be able to do both. And that's kind of what's going on with us. And that's one thing that we've been very evident, especially overseas, in that people have always, we've always done very well over there because they just like what they like. And I think it's starting to go that way here. Obviously, Sam Daver having him Shadows on it was a huge plus for us. Probably one of the biggest metal bands, one of the biggest newer metal bands in America. And he did that because he's a fan of Fozzy, not because he's a fan of me. He's a fan of the band and the songs. And I think that's really going in that direction, which is, if you stick with it long enough and you keep putting out quality material and keep putting on great live gigs, all of the misconceptions and preconceptions get washed away. And all you're left with is a great band that plays killer songs and puts on a great show live. And that's what everybody wants to see.
Talking live with Chris Jericho, it's Eddie Trunk. The new Fozzy album is called Sin and Bones. It's available everywhere tomorrow. Chris is calling from Dallas, where he's getting ready to put the button on this phase of his wrestling career with a performance there tonight. And then I saw on your Twitter that after your Raw gig tonight, you're going to do a signing in Dallas?
Yeah, it's a crazy week, man, because like I said, I'm kind of transitioning between wrestling and Fozzy with the record coming out. So it's the end of one phase, the beginning of another. So like you said, I mean, the album comes out tomorrow, so I wanted to do a midnight signing, here tonight. So I do Raw, then I go do the midnight signing, then I drive 3 hours to Austin where I have a signing tomorrow afternoon at another record store, then do the SmackDown show, then fly to Kansas City where we're rehearsing for Uproar all week. Uproar starts on Friday in Kansas City, then we go to Little Rock on Saturday, then I fly back to Los Angeles to do SummerSlam for the WWE, then fly back to St. Louis to continue the tour with Fozzy. So it's kind of a little bit of a crazy week coming up, but you know how it is for me. It's usually always that way, so I'm used to it.
See, it would seem to me, I mean, obviously the live gigs get in the way, trying to wrestle and also play with the band live, but it would seem to me like there could, if you wanted there to be, there could really be a natural kind of promotional angle between what you're doing with wrestling and this band. Obviously you want to transcend that, but obviously you have no problem with those fans coming along as well. So it would seem like, I mean, if you were out there wrestling across the country, you could almost, it might kill you, but you could almost do that in a lot of markets where you piggyback signings and stuff right off of the wrestling gigs.
Well, we've tried that before. We did it on the other main tour. We actually played shows in the same town for WWE. So we finished the WWE show at 10:30 and then go straight over to the venue and do a Fozzy gig that started at midnight or so. But you can't do both, man. You just can't. And especially, wrestling, I'm such an evil bad guy. At least I was up until a couple of weeks ago. Now I'm a shining good guy again. But, I mean, people can't delineate the two. It's like, oh, he's a jerk in wrestling, so therefore his band must be something we're supposed to boo. And I have to keep them separately so people understand these are two separate things. This is not a celebrity band project. I just woke up one day and went, hey, I'm a singer in a rock and roll band. I've been a singer in a rock and roll band since I was 12 years old, and a bass player. In high school, all we did was play, Metallica songs, Maiden songs. I sang, I played bass. Even when I started wrestling, I still wrote songs and did demos and played shows, in clubs and stuff. I've been playing in a band since I was 12. I was doing it when I was 22, and I'll be doing it when I'm 62. So either enjoy what we do or not, but I'm not stopping. It's part of who I am, and I have to let people know that this is the real deal. And now people know that, and they're embracing it as such, which was a little bit of a hurdle to overcome. But once we did, we got the respect of people like yourself. I mean, you know what I mean? Like you said yourself, you didn't know what to make of it at first. Now you know this is real. There's songs that you like that you play because you like the songs. You can care less who's in the band. And that's kind of what we got going on. And it's just getting bigger and bigger, especially when we do Uproar. I mean, that's probably one of the biggest tours we could be on this summer with bands like Shinedown and Papa Roach, kind of some of the newer bands, which is great for us because we have that vibe too. We're not an 80s metal band. We have elements of that. We also have elements of what's going on now. So it just helps us to do all of these types of shows and all these types of tours, all these different types of bands to show more and more of who we are.
So Chris, it sounds to me that, and listen, wrestling can't be easy as you get older either with how physical that is, but it sounds to me that is, if this Fozzy continues to grow the way it is, and you get to a point where it becomes your, the year-round full-time thing and gets to a level where it is, that level of a commitment, that this will be where your full commitment lies. I mean, is that what you hope for, that you can transition away from doing some of this other stuff and be just a full-time singer and a rock band?
Absolutely, man. I mean, it's like I said, it's a second dream coming true. And that's due to, you know, luck, it's due to skill, but it's also due to a lot of hard work. I mean, we've been doing Fozzy since 1999. And like I said, I mean, the last record, I mean, just the amount of people who were getting into it, you know, it just blew my mind, you know. And just to show that, like, if we were doing these records and doing shows and nobody bought the records and nobody cared and nobody came to the shows, well, then maybe you'd think differently. But it's the opposite. After 13 years, our fan base is growing exponentially with every opportunity we have. So, I mean, I've seen this happen before. I felt the iceberg about to tip, or whatever, the snowball about to go down the hill with Jericho in about 2000 when I first joined the WWE. I could tell that something was brewing that was going to hit. And there's every reason to think that it might not, but I just had a feeling. I had the same feeling about Fozzy. I just know that after all the hard work we've done, and with this new record that we have, and with all the momentum, signing Century Media, which is the biggest record company we've ever been on, doing the Uproar Tour, you know, doing Soundwave in Australia and all these other cool things that are going on. If it continues to go this way, I'd be crazy not to take full advantage and do it full time, because I've been wanting to do this since I was 12 years old, man.
Talking live with Chris Jericho, and the new Fozzy album is out tomorrow if you are in the Dallas area. What's the name of the store you're doing tonight, Chris?
Good Records.
Good Records. So go there, meet Chris, and the other guys going to be there too, or just you?
No, they're on their way to Kansas City right now. So the first couple signs will just be me, but we got all the signings and all the, you know, all the different markets that we're going to be in, and all that stuff at FozzyRock.com. I think we're coming back to JNR in New York. That's that cool place. We're going to be signing there, and, you know, all across the country. So
and also talk about, if you can, you mentioned the song I played before you called in. Sandpaper, which is the single and has Shadows from Avenged on it. Do you have any other guests on this record?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because for whatever reason, a lot of people always call and want to do stuff on our records. We've had Zach Wilde before, and Marty Friedman, Miles Kennedy, Mark Tremonti, Jeff Waters. Shadows came about because there was a part in the song, a Cat Scratch, a Whiplash, a Witch Hunt in Black. I was singing it. I thought it would sound better with a call and response. I called Matt, who's a very good friend of mine. And he not only laid down the part, he kind of rearranged the song, gave us a couple of ideas for the arrangement of it. The other guy who has been calling me incessantly for about a year is Phil Campbell from Motorhead. He's been a big fan of our band for about 5 or 6 years. He came and jammed with us at the Whiskey when we had a show there a couple of years ago. And after that, he's like, oh, we'll play the next Folio. He's got a very sick little shout here. I won't play the next Folio. So he would like call me like or text me, I swear to God, once a month. And I was like, Phil, we're going to get something for you. I promise. And he plays on a song called She's My Addiction, which is a kind of a GNR, Buck Cherry type of a vibe, Motorhead type of vibe. And he laid down an amazing solo. So it was cool to have him involved as well. Once again, kind of shows who we attract. Avenged people, Motorhead people, everyone in between.
And for you personally, how has this process been developing as a singer and as a lyricist and a writer? Because when you sent me advanced tracks of this record, I said to you, man, you're going for it a little bit more vocally here. You're really singing, you're sounds like you're singing higher. I was joking with you. I'm like, don't pull a Joe Elliott and paint yourself into a corner. But I mean, you know, what about that? I mean, is it something you put a lot of time, it sounds like a lot of time working on?
Well, I took vocal lessons after we recorded the All That Remains record back in 05. What the difference was this time is that we did a lot of touring on Jason Grail. We did like 15 countries and I think, I don't know, almost 100 gigs. So there was a lot of shows and a lot of shows in a row. You don't take a lot of days off when we're touring. So you really have to harness your voice and know when to go for it and when to lay back a bit. And that really not only did it strengthen my voice, it gave me a real insight into where my wheelhouse was as a singer. And for Rich, who writes all the melodies, kind of really came up with some great stuff. He pushed me hard in some of the melodies, but there are places where I could really handle it. And I think, you know, a lot of people are saying this is the best vocal performance I've ever done, which is, you know, a big compliment. And there's a couple songs, one song called A Past Life, kind of a Maiden Meets Doors type of thing, where I think it's probably the best thing I've ever done on any record, because it's different. It's very melodic and very soft-spoken. There's another song, Inside My Head, which is like that as well. And then there's the burners, you know, you talk about Sandpaper or She's My Addiction. The opening track, Spider in My Mouth, is probably my favorite song on the record right now. And it's very easy for me to sing. It's not super high. It's just really perfect for what I do and where I sing. So kind of really harness all the different elements of my voice and put them all throughout the record in different places where you can really see the focus and hear the focus of it. And I think it really, you know, panned out good.
Well, FozzyRock.com is the website to learn more and look for concert dates and keep up with everything going on with the band. Before I let you go, man, and go back to your wrestling world for the next however long that lasts, a few days or whatever, of course, we're buds and we talk all the time, and you being a huge music fan, you got your own radio show as well on XM, right?
Yes.
If you want to give that a plug, go ahead.
Yeah, XM 164 on Sixth Sense, the channel, it's called The Rock of Jericho. And you've been an alumni, you've been an illustrious guest of the show. And it's fun because I get a chance just to do what we're doing right now, just talk about music and just shoot the breeze and play some cool tunes and let the artists request what they want to hear, which is always cool.
So along those lines, I want to ask you about a couple, because, again, we talk about this stuff all the time privately, and you know, we love our bands and the music that we love. I want to get your take. First of all, did you see Maiden on this tour? Because you're a Maiden freak.
Yeah, I saw them on this tour, and I thought it was amazing. I thought the set list was great. They just keep seeming to be better and better. I think Bruce and Vocal Matt is better than it was 5 years ago, which is better than it was 25 years ago. I really enjoyed it.
You know what I said was amazing about Bruce that I couldn't believe is, because I just saw them Thursday in Irvine, California, at Irvine Meadows, and I couldn't believe, like, that stage is massive, and the guy is running around it, sometimes at full sprint for 2 hours, and singing that stuff, which is incredible.
The only other guy that I can ever really compare that is old Steve Perry, when you watch the Journey videos from like 8th Street, where he was running all over the stage and just never hitting any bad notes. And then Bruce is totally like that, man. And he just keeps getting younger. And that's what I'm talking about when he gets to music. You can do it to your 70 years old. It's like a car and at the Olympic ceremony. Sounds like, for whatever reason, those guys are just getting better with age. Probably because they don't party as much or do as much drugs. But it sure is cool to see, that's for sure. It's very inspirational.
Yeah, it is. There's a handful of guys that can still do it. A guy, you know, Sammy Hagar is one of them. I mean, there's a few. Most of them don't have what they had when they were younger, regardless of how they lived their life. But there's a couple out there that are the freaks. I just saw Steven Tyler. Aerosmith is just still unbelievable. But so where did you see Maiden? How many shows did you catch?
I just saw one. I actually had a really cool rock and roll day where I went to see Maiden in Atlanta on Friday. Then flew from Atlanta to Atlantic City to go see Avenged Sevenfold and Metallica at the Orion Fest. So it was like the ultimate rock and roll weekend.
Yeah, I just missed you in Atlantic City. I heard you were there. I didn't know you were going. We just missed each other.
Yeah, I know. We did. I mean, just the last minute thing, because once again, Shadows was there. I was like, well, dude, I'll come. I got the day off. But I saw them in Atlanta, which was both the second or third day of the tour. That was Rod at the sound booth and then drank beers and got loaded, so it was cool.
That's usually the plan of attack.
Yeah, that's the MO, that's right.
With Iron Maiden. And what do you, being a big Queensryche fan, what do you make of all this stuff? Because we just taped an episode of That Metal Show with Jeff T. People will see that in a couple weeks. But obviously this thing has gotten ugly beyond belief. And I mean, I know you're a big fan of Queensryche. What's your take on all of it?
It's a drag because the thing I hate the most is the fact that they're taking out all this dirty laundry in the public realm, you know, and there's, you know, three sides to every story, yours, mine, and the truth. And I know Todd Mazur, I met him last year actually in Holland. We played a festival of Crimson Glory, and we were just freaking out over how great of a singer he is. But, you know, and Jeff is a great singer too, so, just, you know, guys got to break up and leave sometimes. I just hate the fact that it had to be done in a public forum, and it seems like it's very hurtful. And I just know if I've been with, you know, my band for 30 years, and it came down to that. It's just sad, man. I just don't like seeing that sort of thing going on, no matter who's right, who's wrong. I just wish they could just keep it between themselves, you know?
Well, I don't know. I kind of like the fact that it's public because I think that it lets the fans in on the cold, hard truth. I mean, that this is a business.
Yeah.
I mean, that, you know, there's so many, and I mean, obviously what I do on this show for years is talking about all factors of the business and having these discussions and these debates. And I think that it's important because people forget, I mean, listen, if you're just a fan and you're not interested in the business side of the music industry, that's fine. And I get that. And you shouldn't have to be. But for those that are, I think it sheds a light on on just, you know, what goes on behind the scenes, who controls what, the battles over, you know, names and stuff, when people can't figure out how, I don't know, Michael Anthony didn't get paid on a Van Halen record, or how does Axl Rose, the only one with the Guns N' Roses name, I mean, all that stuff is always kept behind a dark curtain.
Yeah.
And here, you know, you can have it right out if you want to learn all about it and watch as it unfolds, because according to what Jeff said, it's still going to be another year before they have an actual court date that resolves everything. So it's you know, it's out there if you want to partake in learning about it. But I think that's the only positive about it, is it gives the casual fan a little bit of insight on what really goes on with these bands and the business nature of it.
Well, yeah, and that's one thing, like you said, when you first get into a band, you think, oh my gosh, that band has five records, though, they must be millionaires. And it's not that way. You know, you got to fight and scrimp and make it work every single time. And that's the really cool thing about Fozzy and our business model. We've never lost money on a tour, and it's harder and harder to do nowadays. But when you see the real business part of what the music business is, it kind of takes you out of the fantasy world that we all had when we were teenagers, and just thinking of all the bands and just rocking and making huge money and just getting along every day.
And that they're all friends, and that they're all friends traveling together and drinking beers every night. I mean, that's just, you know, that they're all equal partners. I mean, that is just not the case.
Yeah.
And probably 90% of the bands that everybody loves.
No, again, it's a five-way marriage where you have two or maybe three heads of state. Very rare that it's three. It's mostly two. And then the guys that can last are the guys that know their place. And then they chime in when they're asked, and they keep their mouth shut when they're not. And that's just the way it is. So I think Paul Stanley said, you cannot have a democracy in a band. You'll have one or two leaders, and the other guys play their parts well. And if you can get guys that want to do that and have no problems with it, you can put together a strong band. You mentioned Aerosmith. So all those guys know exactly what their role is and know exactly what they're there to do. You know, and then that's why that band is still together with the original members. I'm sure they're not always happy, but they're still together, and that's the most important thing.
But I don't fully believe that. I do believe, I think that that's a convenient way not to pay people the same amount as everybody else when you say that. I think that when bands first start, you certainly can, and for a long time, have a full democracy, and everybody can be a full band. I think that when those cracks show is when it's no longer the original band, and then you get the division. I mean, that's what happens. And then one or two people wrestle away control of the whole situation. Those are the allegations going back to Queensryche. I mean, in some circles, is that, you know, Jeff and his wife being the manager were the ones that tried to basically wrestle control. I mean, that stuff happens all the time. Whether it's true or not remains to be seen. But I think that it is workable. But then you have situations like, you know, Bon Jovi, where the original bass player is gone. Well, you replace him with a guy who just gets paid, but you don't even say he's in the band. You don't even put him in the pictures. You know, and that guy may be this, Hugh McDonald is his name, may be the best guy, because he doesn't have to deal with any of the BS. He gets a nice fat paycheck to go up there, doesn't have to do meet and greets, signings, do nothing, and, you know, he tours the world and plays bass in Bon Jovi.
Well, it's like you said, if you know your place and you can appreciate that, then you can make a good living, and that's exactly what he's doing.
And I'll tell you, I just saw Aerosmith, you mentioned them recently, and they are unbelievable, and as you said, a true freak in the sense that they're, you know, they're a band that's notoriously dysfunctional off the stage, but on stage, they just all come together amazingly, and they're like one band from any band from the 70s or 80s you can count on one hand that has all this original guys. I mean, that's unheard of, especially when you consider the insanity of those guys. I mean, a few years ago, trying to replace Steven Tyler, that's nuts.
Yeah, but like you said, man, once they get back together and everybody just has to know their role, and I think sometimes guys forget that, but as long as they can all get along knowing that Steven Tyler's the leader, Joe Perry's second in command, and the only guy that can challenge them, then they'll probably stay together for as long as they want to. Then why not?
I'll let you go on this little tidbit. I don't know if you heard about this. I tweeted it out, but we just taped a new episode of That Metal Show, and we had Joey Kramer and Brad Whitford together as the guests, and I talked to them about being kind of the unsung heroes of Aerosmith and the behind-the-scenes guys, and Brad told a really interesting story, which people will see when the show airs. But, you know, I said to them, being honest as I am, I said, listen, I think Steven Tyler's like the greatest living American rock star. I said, it was madness a couple years ago when you were, you know, where you guys couldn't have been serious about trying to replace him. And Brad was like, well, you know, we just were trying to pull him back into the fold. And, you know, if we would have replaced him, we would have called the band something different. And I was like, well, how far did it go? Did you ever actually audition people? Because, I mean, imagine walking in and being the guy, you know, I'm trying to replace Steven Tyler. Mind you, what's really interesting about this is Tyler was going to replace, was actually did audition with the guys from Zeppelin.
Right. Yeah, I know. Miles Kennedy told me that.
Yeah, around the same time. So that's really nuts when you think about the parallel. But Brad and Joey said on camera, and people will see this when the show airs, that the only guy they actually, they never auditioned anybody, but the only guy they actually had a phone conversation with about it was Sammy Hagar.
Wow.
Because they figured, well, Sammy was the one guy who made it work with Van Halen. He's probably the only guy that could make it work in Aerosmith. And they had a conversation, and we had Sammy and Michael on the new season, and they, you know, Sammy admitted he talked to him, but they never got to the point where they actually, you know, rehearsed or anything.
Interesting, because I heard Lenny Kravitz too, but let's just glad that Tyler is back. That's where he belongs.
Yes, of course, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, absolutely. I mean, it's so amazing to have Aerosmith as still the same guys. It's remarkable, man. Well, listen, I know you're prepping for a gig there in Dallas. Have a good one. And again, everybody go pick up the new Fozzy album, Sin and Bones. It's available tomorrow. And when our schedules meet up, man, we'll get you in here and we'll do a metal summit. We'll hang out. We'll do the whole thing.
Sounds good. And yeah, we're on tour. Uproar starts on August 17th. So go to rockstaruproar.com and see what we're playing. But let's play one more tune from Sin and Bones. I'll pull Sebastian Bach on you.
I'm going to do I haven't queued up the first track because you said Spider in My Mouth was your favorite, so I thought we'd do that.
Awesome. That's what I was going to suggest.
All right, man. So I'll play it now, and I'll let you go, and stay in touch. I'll talk to you soon, all right?
Thanks, Eddie. I appreciate it. Looking forward to seeing everybody on the road.
All right, Chris. Anytime, man.
Cheers, man. Bye.
Bye. There goes Chris Jericho checking in from the road where he's performing tonight, or wrestling, or whatever they call it. In the wrestling world, performing, has a show, has a gig, has a match. I don't know the exact wrestling lingo. Haven't followed it since the days of Ivan Putski. But Jericho is obviously getting ready to wind down his wrestling stuff and ramp up the Fozzy stuff because of the new album coming out tomorrow. So thanks, Tim, for calling in. We'll play this Fozzy track, and then we'll continue with more requests and more music that you want to hear. Let us know right now what you want to hear at 866-315-2663. That's the toll-free nationwide phone number. Again, we're live on Sirius XM 39, Trunk Nation on this Monday, back live, hanging with you till 10 o'clock Eastern, and taking your requests. Again, 866-315-2663. We'll go with the solid music at least for the next half hour, so now would be a good time to get a song in. You can also tweet me at Eddie Trunk. I'll try to work a song in that way as well. And then I'll give you a heads up. We've got 2 hours and 45 minutes left to go on our live show, and we haven't had a chance to do any one-on-one conversation. I know a lot of people like to do that, so I'll give you a couple opportunities to jump on the air live. How about we do our first at the top of the hour? So we'll give you 45 solid minutes of nonstop tunes. Make those requests now, and then coming up at the top of the hour, 8 o'clock Eastern, 5 Pacific, our first round of open phones about anything you want to talk about in the world of hard rock and metal. As I mentioned, just back from LA, new episodes of That Metal Show in the can. We can talk about that, mention the Queensryche drama. I saw Iron Maiden just a couple nights ago. We can talk about that. There's a lot of things going on as usual. Sabbath played a show in America at Lollapalooza. I was not there, but by all accounts, it was a good one. So if some people were there and want to call in and give their review, that's cool as well. So that's the plan. Music for 45, your calls and conversation at the top of the hour. Also, one quick note here. I am headed to Vegas. I'm going to be presenting an award to Sammy Hagar at the Vegas Rocks Awards, which are happening at the Hard Rock Casino in Las Vegas. Always look forward to going there and hanging in Vegas, and some great stuff planned this time around. The awards are on the 26th of August, which is a Sunday. And then just prior to that, if you're going, I will be doing a meet and greet and a book signing and selling at the Hard Rock Cafe merch store from 4 to 5 p.m. on that Sunday. So if you go to the Vegas Rocks Awards or you're in the Vegas area, come see me. Come say hello. Sunday, August 26th, 4 to 5 p.m. at the Hard Rock merch store. That's at the Casino and Hotel at the Hard Rock in Vegas. So hope to see you there. More information on eddietrent.com. All right, so back into music with another new one from Fozzy. Your requests, then your phone calls coming up at the top of the hour. It is Eddie Trunk live on Sirius XM 39. And this track is called Spider in My Mouth, brand new from our guest who just hung up, Chris Jericho and his band Fozzy.
Thank you.
There you go, Spider in My Mouth. That is brand new from Fozzie, featuring our guest we just had on the air for about a half an hour, Chris Jericho. Again, the album Sin and Bones is available and in stores everywhere starting tomorrow. It's Eddie Trunk live on Sirius XM 39. Our get-together on Mondays on what we call Trunk Nation until 10 o'clock Eastern. Music and talk that rocks, mixing it up with a lot of cool requests as well. Had a Twitter request for some White Lion.